Good evening. I'm Patrick Lewis, the Director of Collections and Research at the Pilsen Historical Society. Thank you again for joining us for The Nation That Never Was, Reconstructing America's Story. Kermit Roosevelt III is a professor of constitutional law at the University of Pennsylvania Law School, a former clerk for Supreme Court Justice David Souter, a member of the Presidential Commission on the Supreme Court, and an award-winning author. A frequent op-ed contributor, his work has appeared in the New York Times, the Foreign Policy Research Institute, the Washington Times, Time, Newsweek, and The Hill, among many other outlets. He serves as a media expert and keynote speaker, discussing topics including the Supreme Court, civil rights, U.S. presidential history, leadership, American politics, patriotism, and U.S. current events. I'll return to moderate questions after the presentation as time permits. If you have a question, please come to the microphones at the front of the room, or if you're joining us virtually, feel free to drop them in the chat. Welcome to Night Speaker.
Thank you. Thank you for the introduction. Thank you all for coming. It's a real pleasure to be here. In about 45 minutes, I'm going to try to quickly summarize the argument of this book to leave some time for Q&A. So then you can ask me about particular points that you think are interesting, or that you can't believe are true, or whatever strikes your fancy. Generally speaking, I started writing this book because I thought what I was saying was true. I thought I had stumbled across an interesting but compelling interpretation of the Declaration of Independence. But I also ended up thinking that it could be useful in a particular way, because I think that America is facing a particular kind of problem. And the problem is that our national story isn't working anymore. So what is a national story? It's a version of our history that tells us who we are and what we should do, what we should be willing to fight for. It tells us who the heroes and villains of our history are, who we should identify with, who we should emulate, and who we should reject. And it's supposed to inspire. It's supposed to call us together to make sacrifices in the name of shared ideals and our American identity. And we had a story that did this. It's what I call in the book the standard story. Part of what I'm going to say is it never worked as well as some people thought it did. But today, it's clearly not working, I think. People, especially younger people, are rejecting it. They're rejecting it basically because they think the way that we told it wasn't accurate, and if you make it accurate, it's not inspiring. And that's a problem because fundamentally a national story is supposed to inspire. It's supposed to show you a nation that you can believe in, that you can feel proud to be a part of, and that you're willing to fight for. So let me tell you now, just in skeleton form, the standard story. The key idea that I associate with it is the idea that our fundamental American values, by which I mean liberty and equality, are there from the beginning. They're the heart of founding America, the seed from which the American nation grows. They're stated in the Declaration of Independence. All men are created equal and endowed with inalienable liberty. And then they're fought for in the Revolution, and they're made into law by the Constitution of 1787 or 1791, if you add in the Bill of Rights. And then American history is the story of more fully realizing those ideals in a more or less steady progress. And our heroes are the people who champion them. And that would be people like Martin Luther King in 1963 in the I Have a Dream speech in the March on Washington, or Abraham Lincoln in 1863, with the Gettysburg Address, also appealing to the Declaration. And of course, the original Thomas Jefferson, 1776, the Declaration of Independence. And the standard story is telling us that those three moments are fundamentally the same. Americans are coming together in the name of the Declaration of Independence to fight for equality. And it's telling you that we are the same America with the same values at each of those moments. The same values, the same Constitution, the same nation. Now, I don't know how convincing that is to you. Sort of depends on the audience. I've given this to a bunch of different audiences. I'm not 100% sure what kind of an audience you are. Perhaps we'll find out more during the Q&A. But I think a lot of people don't find it very convincing. And I went backwards in time there. I said 1963, then 1863, then 1776, to try to make the transition a little bit less jarring, because I didn't want to say the people who championed liberty and equality, like Thomas Jefferson in 1776. And the degree to which I find that a jarring thing to say has a lot to do with the fact that I've thought about this sort of obsessively for the past 10 years. And I know that not everyone feels this way. I gave this talk in Virginia also, where many people are quite fond of Thomas Jefferson. But there are a bunch of pretty creepy things about Jefferson. He enslaved his own children, for instance. And personally, I would not hold him up as an embodiment of American values if I wanted people to believe that American values were good. And I think that increasingly people, and I said particularly younger people, feel that way. So that's the problem that we're facing. It's sort of a dilemma, right? We want to be truthful on the one hand. We want to face the truths about our history, but we also want to be positive and patriotic, right? We don't want to teach children that America is a bad country. But as the standard story gets more accurate, it gets less inspiring. So what is the solution to this dilemma? Well, one thing you could try to do is you could try to prop up the standard story. You could try to defend it from alternative views. You could require public school teachers to teach it. So there's a law in Florida that requires teachers to present American history as the development of a nation based on the universal principles of the Declaration of Independence, which I think, fairly interpreted, does ban my book from Florida public schools. It's a point of pride. And you could forbid people from offering alternative viewpoints. You could ban the 1619 Project, for instance, which school districts around the country have done. And this is what is happening with the so-called anti-CRT, anti-critical race theory laws. These are essentially attempts, I think, to support the standard story by excluding critical viewpoints. And I think ultimately that's not going to work, because I think the alternative viewpoints are too persuasive and too well-established. And we had a cultural and ideological struggle over whether it is permissible to criticize the founding and question the goodness of founding America. And I think that is pretty much over. We decided it's okay to look critically at founding America. And I don't think it's possible to use law to reverse what is essentially a cultural shift there, not without getting substantially more authoritarian. So I'm not a supporter of attempts to protect the standard story. And in fact, one of the things that I do in the book is to look at some of its weaknesses. That's something a lot of people have done. Much of what I say there is not especially original, although I do have a reading, the Declaration of Independence, that might surprise you. You don't hear it much nowadays, but I do think it's actually the original understanding. So criticism of the standard story, that's been done. It's mostly a negative project. And the positive thing that I do, which I think is more original, is to offer a different story. So I have a story that I think is both more accurate and more inspiring, one that shows us an America that we can believe in, a story that is more useful and more inclusive, or you could say, and I'll return to this right at the end, a story that includes the right people and excludes the right people too. So in some ways, this is not radical, right? This is certainly not anti-American. This is a patriotic venture. I also think the 1619 Project is deeply and conventionally patriotic. I wouldn't call it radical. And in some ways, I would say I'm actually more radical than the 1619 Project, because the 1619 Project still basically is telling the standard story. It says our ideals were stated in 1776, they weren't realized at the time, and we fought progressively over our history to make them true. And those are the two keys to the standard story, right? Our ideals are there at the beginning. We've worked to realize them. We are the same America we've always been. And those are the ideas that I reject. So now let me tell you quickly how I reject them. And to situate what I'm saying in terms of conventional mainstream historical scholarship, I think that 80% really of what I'm saying is conventional wisdom. It's accepted by mainstream historians. And then the other 20% is actually kind of radical. But it's not different facts. It's not new facts. It's not even really new interpretations of existing facts, although a couple times maybe it is. Mostly it's just things that I think follow almost logically, pretty clearly, from accepted facts, but that we just haven't been willing to accept. So here's the first example. The Declaration of Independence, as it was understood in 1776, does not contain our modern ideals of liberty and equality. And we think it does because we hear the phrase, all men are created equal, and we think it means something about how the government should treat people, should treat them equally, or should treat them with equal concern and respect, or should value them equally, something like that. And that is what Martin Luther King is saying in 1963, and it is what Abraham Lincoln is saying in 1863, but it's not what Thomas Jefferson is saying in 1776. And the technical explanation of this is, in 1776, educated people hearing that phrase would understand it as an invocation of conventional Enlightenment social contract theory, which is the widely accepted political philosophy of the time. And what it means, again, this is a little bit technical, but what it means is, in the state of nature, which is a hypothetical, imaginary world with no government and no laws, no one has an obligation to obey anyone else. So if people just popped into existence, if, in the words of the Declaration, they were created, in that world, there would be no legitimate political authority. And the point of this, for the Declaration, is to reject the divine right of kings. To say, no one is chosen by God at birth to rule over others legitimately. Legitimate political authority comes from somewhere else. But that's really all it means in the Declaration. So it doesn't mean that once a government has been formed, it should treat people equally. It doesn't mean that for the insiders, the people who form the government and consent to its authority and whose rights it is supposed to protect, doesn't have to treat them equally. And it certainly doesn't mean that for outsiders who are not part of the political community. So the statement, all men are created equal, as a matter of philosophy, is perfectly consistent, in fact, with enslaving outsiders, people who are not members of the political community. And again, the historians who have studied the Declaration and its context agree with, I would say, 80% of this. They agree that all men are created equal is, in fact, the social contract theory of John Locke, and it works in the argument the way that I've described. They just sort of assume that somehow it's also this statement of broad moral principles that we take it to be nowadays. It means the government should treat people equally. It means that slavery is wrong. But it would have made no sense for Jefferson to say that. It wouldn't have helped the argument. It would have undermined it by making the colonists look like oppressors. We know that when Jefferson put in a passage that seemed critical of slavery, the Continental Congress took it out. And we also know that in 1776, people didn't think the preamble was very significant. So the historical evidence is very strongly against our modern understanding of all men created equal being the understanding in 1776. So, I've said the Declaration doesn't have these ideals. Moving on to the next part of the standard story, it would then be sort of surprising if the Revolution was a war for them, and in fact it wasn't. And maybe the best way to see this is to look at the relationship between the Revolution and slavery, because slavery is clearly contrary to these modern ideals of liberty and equality. And the standard story wants to tell us that the Revolution was fundamentally a war against slavery. Noted historian Gordon Wood said, slavery existed everywhere without substantial criticism until the American Revolution made it a problem for the world. But again, if you go back to the perspective of 1776, this is a very strange thing to say. In the Revolution, neither side is fighting to end slavery, but the British are undoing it where it's convenient for them, and they're arming the formerly enslaved and dressing them in uniforms with sashes that say liberty to slaves. And the Americans are saying in response, this is basically the worst imaginable thing you could do. There's a British member of parliament, David Hartley, who in fact proposes to Benjamin Franklin as a peace offering that the British will restore the pre-1763 status quo They will repeal all of the remaining acts that were passed after the French and Indian War, the acts that the colonists were complaining about. If the colonists agree to one thing, which is giving enslaved people a right to trial by jury as a first step towards abolition. That's what Hartley said. And Benjamin Franklin, who I think is one of the best founders, way better than Thomas Jefferson, and I'm not saying that just because I'm from Philadelphia, Franklin really is better. He invented flippers, for one thing. But Franklin writes back and says, by inciting slave rebellions, you have proven yourselves unworthy to rule us. Like, there's no going back from this terrible thing you have done. So different people did understand the revolutionary ideology differently. Some people did think that it was inconsistent with slavery. But the question that I'm really interested in on that is whether those people are the founding fathers. Is that Thomas Jefferson? Is that the Continental Congress? Or are they more the dissenters and the outsiders in founding America? And to answer that question, I think, you can look at the moments where the colonies speak with one voice. And that's the Declaration of Independence, for one, where the colonists complain about the British emancipation to the people that they enslaved. And then also the Treaty of Paris, which ends the revolution, where the colonists demand that the British depart North America without carrying away, as they put it, any Negroes or other property of the inhabitants. So the British actually defied that treaty obligation. They did keep their promise of freedom to people who had made it to the British line. And American diplomats pursued it for decades, demanding compensation for the people that the British had freed. So that's the revolution. What about the 1787 Constitution? That really has nothing at all to do with the liberty or equality of individuals. So the 1787 Constitution contains zero provisions that protect the natural rights of individuals from other individuals, which is what the governments described in the Declaration of Independence are supposed to be doing. The federal government that the Constitution creates doesn't protect individuals' natural rights from other individuals either. So Congress couldn't then, Congress in fact can't now, pass a law that prohibits one American from killing another, except in special circumstances that would make it a matter of federal concern. So the most basic protection of your natural rights, the protection of your life, is actually beyond the power of the federal government in most circumstances. And the reason for that is that the 1787 Constitution is what you could call geostrategic in its orientation. It's creating a federal government that can make the states cooperate and pull their weight, and that can handle issues that can't be left up to the states, things like international relations. But for most individual to individual interactions, whether one person is violating another person's natural rights is just not an issue of federal concern. It's all left up to the states. Except for one particular context, where the 1787 Constitution does pay attention to violations of natural rights. It notices, you could say, that some people are violating other people's right to liberty. Some people are enslaving other people. And it notices this because it's a source of interstate friction, which the Constitution is supposed to manage, and it reacts by trying to manage that friction, generally by protecting and rewarding slavery. So it protects the international slave trade until 1808. It abridges the sovereignty of free states by requiring them to return fugitives, and it gives slave states extra voice in every branch of the federal government. Extra representatives directly through the Three-Fifths Compromise, extra electors in the selection of the president, because a state's number of electors is determined in part by its number of representatives, and then because the president picks judges, extra voice in the composition of the federal judiciary. So that's the Three-Fifths Compromise. And then one more thing. The 1787 Constitution contains a rule that Congress can't ban slavery in the territories and that black people can never be U.S. citizens. Now, depending on your legal background, your immediate reaction to that might be, well, that's not the Constitution. That's what the Supreme Court said in Dred Scott. Because it is. I've just invoked the infamous Dred Scott decision. And you might be thinking, everyone knows Dred Scott is wrong. But I think there are two things to say about that. The first is, even if we're just trying to interpret the 1787 Constitution correctly, I do think Dred Scott is pretty clearly wrong that Congress can't ban slavery in the territory. That's the sort of compromise that a geostrategic government would be able to enact. But I am less sure that it's wrong on its citizenship holding. That might be a bad reading of the 1787 Constitution, or it might be a good reading, and it might be the Constitution that's bad. Because the 1787 Constitution does have some bad pro-slavery provisions, and the reading that seven justices gave it there is not crazy. And then second, perhaps more important, saying that Dred Scott is wrong doesn't actually absolve the 1787 Constitution of responsibility for that decision, which is what I think most people are trying to do when they insist that Dred Scott is wrong. Because, as I said, Dred Scott is a 7-2 decision. And you can say, oh, but those seven were biased pro-slavery judges, and maybe they were, but then you have to explain how we got seven biased pro-slavery judges on the Supreme Court. And the answer to that is pro-slavery presidents, whom we get in part because of the Three-Fifths Compromise. So the bottom line there is Dred Scott is not an aberration in antebellum America. It's not the product of bad apple individual racists. It's more the product of systemic racism, where the system is the 1787 Constitution. So can you say that Dred Scott is right, or at least that Dred Scott is a predictable consequence of the system, and not condemn America, and not be saying terrible things about modern America? Well, I think you can't, right? I think it's very hard if you're trying to tell a story of continuity, and the progressive realization of founding values, a story where we're the same nation that we've always been. But you can if you want to tell a different story, a story of rupture, where founding America maybe wasn't that great, and it was defeated and overthrown. And we are the heirs not of the founders, but of the people who destroyed their America. And that's what I say is the better story. So what is that about? Well, it's about American ideals as basically the product of dissent, which our standard story says too, but not dissent against monarchical England, dissent against founding America. There are people who look at founding America and realize that it's an unjust society, and they set out to change it. And these people are, in my story, primarily abolitionists. It's abolitionists who pick up the phrase, all men are created equal, and start reading it differently. And again, the historical scholarship on this, I think, is pretty strongly in my favor. Abolitionists start reading all men are created equal, not for equality in the state of nature, which is the original political philosophy understanding, what I call Jefferson's equality, but for equality in society, which I call Lincoln's equality, or universal equality. So abolitionists put this new reading on the Declaration, and they do this, I think, primarily because they have nothing else to rely on. The 1787 Constitution, as I said, is kind of pro-slavery. It's sufficiently pro-slavery that abolitionist William Lloyd Garrison publicly burns a copy, calling it a covenant with death and an agreement with hell. There's no other federal document that really even gestures at equality. So if you want to fight slavery, if you want to say America is an anti-slavery nation, the Declaration is your best bet. And this reading prevails. And the Republican Party wins the presidency in 1860, and of course, the South secedes. So now we have a war, which is a crisis. And of course, it's also a great opportunity for change. But initially, it's important to understand Abraham Lincoln doesn't want that. Lincoln wants to restore the status quo. And the theme of all of his early speeches is union. But then, around 1863, something changes. The word nation replaces the word union in his speeches. The United States becomes a singular phrase. The United States is, rather than a plural phrase. United States are. And Lincoln says slavery will end. That's the Emancipation Proclamation. There will be a new birth of freedom. That's the Gettysburg Address. Right? Things are going to be different going forward. We're changing our society. So what's happening there? Well, the best way to think about it is to distinguish between two different types of revolution. existing regime is unjust and must be destroyed. So that would be the French Revolution, right, against the monarchy, or the Russian Revolution against the Tsar. And the other type is what I call the status quo revolution. So the idea is the existing regime is fine, but we're being denied the rights that we are due under it. And that's the first American Revolution, where the colonists complained basically that they are being denied their rights as English. The Confederates, it's important to understand, are not repudiating the U.S. Constitution. When they write their Confederate Constitution, it looks very much like the 1787 Constitution. What's going on, they say, is just that free states and the national government are distorting and twisting this Constitution, and they're denying us the rights that we were guaranteed when we joined. But what happens in 1863 is that the Civil War changes from a status quo revolution to a regime change. Not on the part of the Confederacy, because they're still fighting for what they always were, but on the part of the United States, which is what I call the United States. The existing regime is unjust and must be destroyed. That's the message of the Emancipation Proclamation. That's the message of the Gettysburg Address. And we look back now, and this is the 80% that everyone agrees with, and we say yes, right, in 1863, we see this turning point where the goal is no longer restoration of the Union, but the end of slavery, and of course, Lincoln wants to destroy the Confederate regime because it's unjust. But here's the controversial 20%, that's not the regime he's before. So remember, the 1787 Constitution singles out slavery for special protection. It says, or it implies, if you believe seven justices, that Congress can't ban slavery, that black people can never become U.S. citizens. So if you ban slavery, as the 13th Amendment does, if you grant birthright citizenship, as the 14th Amendment does, you are destroying that political regime. You are destroying founding America. And the standard story says, well, no, not really, because we're doing it through the amendment process set out in Article 5. And what we're really doing is putting the values of the Declaration into the Constitution. That's what the 14th Amendment does. So this is the mainstream historical view. I think the values that go into the Constitution with the 14th Amendment are not actually the values of the Declaration. But mainstream historians will say this is continuity, right? This is vindication of the promise of 1776. But this is one of those things that, having thought about this for 10 years, now strikes me also as just completely unconvincing. So think about the Civil War and Reconstruction. And let's ask, which side is founding America on? So we can start with the Declaration of Independence. It seems pretty clear to me now, the Declaration of Independence supports the Confederates. They are, after all, declaring their independence. And they are doing so because they think a different form of government will better affect their happiness. And they're not wrong in that belief. I mean, I think they're wrong in that their society was unjust, but they built their society around slavery, and they joined a union with a governing charter that protected that institution in several ways. And the national government has now fallen into the hands of people who want to destroy it. The Republican Party does want to end slavery. So the Declaration of Independence says governments get their just authority from the consent of the governed, and the Confederates say, we're withdrawing our consent, we're going to start over. They say this explicitly in their secession documents. They invoke the Declaration of Independence. And Lincoln, who says he's fighting in the name of the Declaration of Independence, right, in the Gettysburg Address, and that's why I think most people would tell you the Declaration supports Lincoln. What Lincoln is saying is, no, you cannot leave the Union. Right? I reject your independence. And also, I'm going to remake your society against your will. That's the new birth of freedom, without your consent. So that one, I think, is really not close. You can make the same argument about the 1787 Constitution, and I think it's closer. It's not as clear. But the general point that I would make there is the founders thought the national government was the dangerous one. They thought it might become a threat to citizens' rights. And if that happened, the states would stand up to defend them. So the Revolutionary War, where the state militias fight off the redcoats, That's the model that is built into the 1787 Constitution. And again, that's the Civil War. So you can read Federalist 46 to confirm this, where James Madison, slave owner from Virginia, of course, is reassuring readers that the states will always be more important than the federal government and will defeat it in a war if necessary. So what will happen if the federal government starts interfering with how states want to run their societies, he asks. And certainly his fellow Virginians reading that are thinking about, among other things, slavery. If necessary, he says, it would come to force. And that would be like the revolution. 13 states against the federal government. Of course the states would win. Think of the Patriots marching under their Betsy Ross flag with 13 stars in a circle. In 1776, by the way, every state recognizes slavery. So each one of those 13 stars represents a slave state. And of course, this is exactly what happens. 13 states, if you accept the Confederate claims to Missouri and Kentucky, I'm not sure how people feel about that here. But one of the reasons that the Confederacy was so adamant about including Missouri and Kentucky was they wanted 13 stars in a circle, so that they could claim to be the true heirs of the American Revolution. And that's what they had. That was the first flag of the Confederacy. It's just what Madison predicted, but the states didn't. And what I'm arguing is, founding America loses there too. So it loses in terms of the substance of the Declaration of Independence, because rather than the ability to separate and the consent of the governed, you get forced union, you get forced inclusion of black citizens against the will of the former Confederates. And it loses in terms of the substance of the 1787 Constitution too, and not just with slavery. So the Reconstruction Amendments really turn the Founders' Constitution upside down, you could say, because now the federal government is the good guy and the states are the bad guy. From Madison's perspective, I think you could very fairly say the bad guys won the Civil War. So with the Reconstruction Amendments, now the federal government is protecting individuals. And in fact, the first constitutional provision that puts limits on what one individual can do to another is the 13th Amendment, banning slavery. And then the 14th Amendment rejects the laws of slavery as if they were no more valid than rebel death. So uncompensated emancipation. This doesn't seem very radical now, I suspect, because it's so obviously the right thing to do. But it's pretty radical at the time. And what it suggests, I think, is that the laws of slavery are being deemed never valid, right? They're part of a political order that is being overthrown and rejected. So one thing the 14th Amendment says is, there shall be no payment of rebel debt. All such claims are illegal and void. And then, in the very same sentence, it says, there shall be no claims for emancipation. All such claims are illegal and void. And again, maybe that doesn't seem radical to you, because you're thinking, of course, we reject claims based on Confederate debt. Of course, we reject claims based on Confederate laws of slavery. But the crucial point is, those weren't Confederate laws. So they existed before secession. Every state had them in 1776. They existed after secession in states that stayed in the Union. Delaware, Maryland, again, maybe Missouri and Kentucky, if you think they stayed. And then they were all wiped away because the existing regime was unjust and had to be destroyed, and that regime was not the Confederacy. It was founding America. That's why Delaware and Maryland, Missouri and Kentucky are affected too. And then the second point, which I think is maybe even stronger, is that founding America loses in the process of Reconstruction too. How does this happen? Well, the former Confederate states accept that slavery is over, at least in name, and they ratify the 13th Amendment. Those are the former Confederate states doing. But they are not willing to accept black citizenship, which is what the first sentence of the 14th Amendment did, birthright citizenship. This is, in fact, why John Wilkes Booth kills Abraham Lincoln and says so explicitly. Former Confederate states are not willing to accept this. They reject the 14th Amendment. So does Delaware. So does Maryland. And by 1867, it's clear that the 14th Amendment is not going to be ratified. So Congress enacts the Reconstruction Act, and it wipes out the former Confederate states. It says no governments exist in these states. It places the South under military control. And then it makes new states. So they have the same name, they have the same geography, but there's a different political community because Congress says now the formerly enslaved are citizens. And there's a different distribution of political power because Congress says hold new constitutional convention, write new constitution, the formerly enslaved can participate, the former Confederates can't. So you get very different constitutions from the pre-secession constitution, and you get very different legislatures from the 1861 or even 1865 legislature. The legislatures that ratify the 13th Amendment in 1865, they look a lot like the legislature that voted for secession in 1861. So those are clearly the same states, I would say. Black people are not citizens. The legislatures are basically white Democrats. But the legislatures that ratify the 14th Amendment in 1868 look very different. They're racially integrated and they're Republican. And those are the states that ratify the 14th Amendment. So there are three different versions, I think, of the ratification of the 14th Amendment out there. Most people, if you ask them, would probably say, well, it's just ratified through the ordinary Article 5 process, which I think is clearly not true. And historians will tell you it was sort of forced on the South, and Congress coerced the former Confederate states into ratifying. And I'm telling you, I think that is also a bad description. So the legislatures that ratified the 13th Amendment maybe were coerced. They weren't necessarily anti-slavery, but they understood they had no choice. The legislatures that ratified the 14th Amendment, on the whole, were happy to ratify it. They were not coerced because they were pro-equality, racially integrated Republican legislatures. They were the legislatures of new states. So new states ratify these new amendments. They create a new constitution, and just like the first ratification, this creates a new nation. Founding America, I'm telling you, is destroyed in the process of Reconstruction. If there's anything that would have upset the founders, it's Congress annihilating 10 states. Dissolving our legislatures is actually one of the complaints in the Declaration. Rendering the military superior to the civilian power is another. Emancipating our slaves, actually, is another complaint in the Declaration. And King George never went as far as the Reconstruction Congress. What happens in Reconstruction is not the consent of the governed. It's not a people defining itself the way the Declaration says. It's a political community and a political structure that's imposed from above. So it's a regime change revolution coming from above. So the short takeaway is American history, I'm saying, is not a story of continuity. It's a story of failure and reinvention. We should not think that the 1787 Constitution has served us well for over 200 years. We should think that it lasted about 80 and it failed. And we should think that we are not the heirs of founding America, but the heirs of the people who destroyed it. So why is this a better story? Well, I think it's better, I said before, because it's more accurate. We don't have to gloss over as much horrible stuff if we're saying our heroes are the heroes of Reconstruction rather than the founding. I think it's more inspiring because it has less horrible stuff. If you compare Madison, Jefferson, even Hamilton, to say Thaddeus Stevens, Charles Sumner, Hiram Neville, Robert Small, Harriet Tubman, the heroes of Reconstruction are better heroes. And I think it teaches better lessons. And I've got one general point, one more specific point on that. If the Patriots of 1776, and I'll say one more thing about inclusion and exclusion, and then we'll do a Q&A and look at the time just about. So what are the lessons that the standard story teaches? If the Patriots of 1776 are our heroes, and the people that we are supposed to emulate, and the Declaration of Independence is a sacred text for us, what are we being told to do? We're being told to focus kind of obsessively on injustices we feel have been done to us. So lots of complaints in the Declaration about things the British have done, while ignoring the injustices that we maybe are inflicting on others. So the colonists complain that King George is sort of figuratively trying to make them into slaves while they are literally enslaving 500,000 people. Who's better than that? Maybe the U.S. Army of 1865, which is fighting to bring freedom to others. So the Civil War Reconstruction, that's about making sacrifices in the name of justice. The lesson there is look for injustice in the world, even if it's not your fault, and try to make the world better. And then there's a particular way that this echoes into the present day, because the standard story tells us that white paramilitary fighting the national government are the good guys, even if maybe what they're doing is technically insurrection or treason, because they're the sons of liberty. They're the Minutemen, and they're fighting the oppressors. And if you focus on Reconstruction, that story tells you something very different, something really the opposite. It tells you that white paramilitaries fighting the national government are the bad guys, because they are the white men, or the red shirts, or the Klan, and they are fighting the liberators. So which of those is better on that concrete point? Well, we recently saw some white paramilitaries fighting the national government. That was the Proud Boys, the Oath Keepers, the 3%ers. And they were there at the Capitol on January 6th, and they were flying their Revolutionary War flag. They were also flying a Confederate battle flag, because they saw a connection there. And they were saying, we're doing the right thing, even if it's technically insurrection or treason, because we're fighting the oppressor. So I think relatively clearly we want a story that says those are the bad guys, not a story that suggests that people like them are the heroes. And then the last point about inclusivity and exclusivity. Why don't we tell this story? I think it's complicated, but I think the main reason is that there are people who have difficulty seeing themselves in Reconstruction. There are people who have difficulty identifying with the people that I've presented as the heroes of this story. And I think that that has led us to avoid focusing on Reconstruction. But the thing to understand there is that no story is going to be perfectly inclusive. And there are people who have trouble seeing themselves in the founding. And we should think about those two groups of people. So the people who have trouble seeing themselves in the founding, who have some difficulty saying that's where my American ideals come from, are people who think that writing all men are created equal doesn't make up for enslaving their children. People who have some trouble with Thomas Jefferson as a hero. And the people who have trouble seeing themselves in Reconstruction are basically people who identify with the Confederates. And there are reasons why, you know, one region of the country feels that more strongly, maybe. And one of the things that I've said here, Confederates have a strong claim, I think, to be the heirs of founding America, but they were fighting a war to preserve a society that was built on slavery. And if we have to marginalize one of these groups and make them wonder whether America really shares their values, I think we've been marginalizing the wrong one. Right? I think we've decided to make people comfortable by focusing on the founding, thinking that that is a moment where all Americans can look back, because all Americans were united, and we can all see ourselves in the founding. But I think that's not as true. And this is what I meant by saying the standard story doesn't work as well as its supporters thought. I think that's not as true as we believe. So the costs there are higher. And I do think this is in part what the battle over critical race theory is about, but the people don't want white children to be exposed to history that makes them feel uncomfortable or guilty, I think. But I think we can shift. I think we're ready to do this. I've sort of always thought the sign of our maturation as a nation or as a society will be when we can look to Reconstruction and say, that's where our values come. And I think now we're ready to do that.
Thank you so much.
We do have microphones at either side of the room. Please line up and ask your questions. Also, if you're joining us quickly, again, get those in the chat, and I'll try to work those in as we can. I'm thinking as you're speaking tonight that we are on the edge of the 250th anniversary of the Declaration of Independence. There are national commissions. There are state-level commissions. Those of us in the public history and humanities world are having these conversations about how shall we commemorate? What should we do? What programs should we put in place? I wondered sort of your thoughts on what the shape of these national celebrations will look like, and maybe how can some of those conversations be framed as
well? Well, you know, if it were up to me, I would try to make it sort of a goodbye to the Declaration. So one of the things that I say sometimes is there's something nice about the standard story. It has a nice form because it gives you a short document that states our ideals, right? And you can memorize that. And that's the Declaration of Independence. Although, of course, people don't memorize all of it. People just sort of memorize the preamble. And then there's a war that's fought for these ideals, which shows you that people are willing to lay down their lives for them. And that's the Revolution. And then there's a longer document that makes them into law, which is the 1787 Constitution. And I've said, you know, none of those is really very convincing if you look at it critically, I think. But the structure is sort of key. And one of the things that I say sometimes I say in the book is we can keep the same structure. We just have to shift things around a little bit and basically move 80 years forward. So the short document that states our ideals is the Gettysburg Address. And you can memorize the whole thing, and people do. And the war for those ideals is the Civil War. And the longer document that makes them into law is the Reconstruction Constitution with the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments. So, you know, if it were totally up to me, it would be something like the Declaration of Independence, farewell, not good riddance, but, you know, we're moving forward. And it's important, I think, to understand the way that the Declaration was transformed and the way that it turns into something that Lincoln can rely on. But I don't think we need to do that anymore. So the key comparison here for me is Lincoln in 1863 invokes the Declaration of Independence. Of course he does. What else is he going to say? Right? He's not going to rely on the 1787 Constitution. Martin Luther King in 1963, why is he invoking the Declaration of Independence? Did he just not think about it? Was he convinced by Abraham Lincoln? I don't think so. Because in 1944, as a high school junior, Martin Luther King entered an oratory contest with a speech called The Negro and the Constitution, which was basically about the same thing as I Have a Dream, about the question of what determines how blacks in America should be treated. And that speech was all about Reconstruction. And he talked about conquering Southern armies with the sword. And he said that if blacks were given the rights to which they were entitled, they would defend the arc of federal liberty, even with arms against the traitor. So that, I think, is sort of a historically more accurate take on America. And it's what Martin Luther King was saying in 1944. And then in 1963, he shifted totally. Right? The I Have a Dream speech doesn't talk about war. It doesn't talk about traitors. It doesn't talk about Reconstruction. It had a brief mention of the emancipation document. But then it goes to the founding, and it's sort of like all Americans are united in this great historical moment, and we can all hold hands and move forward together. And I believe that he's doing that for strategic reasons, because he's trying to broaden his appeal, and he's trying to enlist white Americans in support of his cause. But what he comes to realize, I think, is that that actually didn't work. So that when you try to get all Americans together in the name of 1776, you get a unity that leaves black Americans behind. And you can see this pretty vividly in 1876, where the centennial is going on. So it's again like this moment of commemoration. And there's this painting, The Spirit of 76, famous painting by Archibald McNeil Willard, that tours the country and bringing Americans back together. And the compromise of 1876 brings Americans back together, but it brings Americans back together by abandoning Reconstruction. And sort of the message of 1876 is we're going back to 1776. America is united. Forget the commitment to equality. So I would want us to understand the ways in which the unity of the founding sort of papers over, or in some ways is actually based on, inequality. And the unity of Reconstruction, which didn't last for very long, but the unity of Reconstruction was a different kind of unity, because that was actually based on a commitment to equality. And again, like the people who are marginalized at these two moments, in 1776, of course, you're marginalizing enslaved people. You're marginalizing abolitionists. You're marginalizing people who don't want to compromise their values by accepting slavery. During Reconstruction, you're marginalizing and excluding people too. Right? And Congress explicitly did that. The 14th Amendment explicitly did that. It excluded from the political life of the Reconstructed South people who had taken an oath to support the Constitution and then waged war against it. And going back to the last thing I said, we have to choose who we're going to marginalize and who we're going to exclude. And Reconstruction had it right, and the founding had it wrong from that perspective.
Thank you very much for that. Helps clarify a lot for me as to why my own confusion about why the original immigrants could apply only to the late 18th century, but not to the 13th, 14th, 15th. But you just alluded to my question a little bit, which is Reconstruction didn't last very long. And with the, you know, the failure of Reconstruction, the rise of new constitutions in the South, and the rise of Jim Crow, I'm kind of saying that that was a third revolution, not that I want it to be, but I'm wondering how you interpret all that.
Yeah, so I interpret American history as cyclical, I guess, with that. And the way that I think about it, the way that I describe it in the book, is that there are two different ideologies. One is what I call exclusive individualism, which is what I associate with the founding. So you've got a political community that's closed. Dred Scott is sort of the perfect example of that, where they say black people have never become US citizens. And you've got a focus on individual rights, which is a little bit more complicated, and I talk better in the book. But one idea that comes from the Declaration and that the Supreme Court actually announces as part of our constitutional law, even interestingly after Reconstruction, is this idea that redistribution or the government attempts to promote equality are constitutionally suspect. So that's sort of the individual idea. And the other ideology is what I call inclusive equality, where the idea is we are inclusive, birthright citizenship is the key example of that. And it's definitely permissible for the government to try to promote equality. That's an important government interest. And I think that these two ideologies sort of clash repeatedly through American history. The founding is an era mostly of exclusive individualism. Reconstruction is inclusive equality. And then the failure of Reconstruction or the overthrow, what historians call redemption, so I usually refer to it as redemption, that's sort of the return of exclusive individualism. And history doesn't stop then either, because after Jim Crow and segregation, you get the civil rights movement, which is what historians call the second Reconstruction. So the values of inclusive equality come back with the Warren Court and the civil rights legislation of the 1960s. But again, right, American history doesn't stop then, and you get something else. You get the Reagan Revolution, I would say. And how do you interpret the Reagan Revolution? What's going on there? Well, one thing that he talks about is originalism. And originalism is sort of saying, we're going to bring back the founding. So interestingly, they never talk about the original understanding of Reconstruction, as you mentioned. They're bringing back the founding. They're getting rid of the excesses of the Warren Court. And one way of thinking this is, take away Reconstruction, you have the founding. Another way of thinking about it is, take away Reconstruction, you have the Confederacy. And part of what I'm saying is there's a lot of overlap between the ideology of the founding and the ideology of the Confederacy. And Reagan is kind of playing on that, sort of almost deliberately. So Reagan kicks off his 1980 campaign with a speech in Philadelphia, talking about states' rights. And you might think, of course, right, it's the founding. Philadelphia, we think of the 13 states fighting the British. But no, right, it's not Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, it's Philadelphia, Mississippi. And when you think about 13 states fighting the national government in Mississippi, it's the 13 states of the Confederacy. So I think of Reagan's presidency as really sort of initiating a second redemption. And a lot of what has followed makes a fair amount of sense from that perspective, because among the Reagan appointees and among more recent conservative appointees to the Supreme Court, you do see originalism. You see it less with the Reconstruction Amendments than with other parts of the Constitution. And you see a pushback against national power, which you could associate with the founding. But the pushback has been most effective with respect to Congress's power to enforce the Reconstruction Amendments. So this is getting into sort of technical constitutional law stuff, but the Supreme Court has said some things about limiting the power of the national government to regulate interstate commerce. It hasn't actually done a whole lot. It's done a lot with respect to Congress's power to enforce the 14th Amendment, striking down the Violence Against Women Act, striking down various other anti-discrimination laws. And it's done a lot with Congress's power to enforce the 15th Amendment, the Voting Rights Act. So we're seeing a real pushback, I think, against Reconstruction. And that's sort of how I understand the progress.
Thank you for speaking to us this evening. I find your talk very informative. But I noticed that it seems like you seem to be defining the revolution of 1776 through the lens of the Democratic Republican ideology, which was, of course, the Southern ideology as well. And so I guess my question is, have you given any consideration to the fact that it's also a Federalist vision of the family, which presented a Northeastern, Northern abolitionist movement? Reflected in the preamble, which had reference to the blessings of liberty. Also, Governor Morris, who was the stylist of the Constitution, spoke out strongly against slavery at the Constitutional Convention, albeit he agreed to the compromises, but there were strong voices on the federal side of the ballot. So I guess my chief criticism of your thesis is to be developed. Taken into account, you don't seem to tonight having taken into account the Northern Federalist viewpoint of the revolution instead of buying into a Southern view of the narrative. And I would submit that there might be another competing vision of what the narrative is from 1776 that might be an alternative to the narrative that you're proposing that we adopt from the
discussion. Yeah, so I think that's a very good point. I think that, you know, we'd say founding America is a they and not an it. And if you look at what follows the revolution in northern states, right, abolition. So abolitionist ideology seems to be spurred on by the revolution in some states. So I'm certainly not giving that as much prominence as our standard story does. I don't mean to be totally overlooking it. Like I say, different people did interpret the revolution differently. I'm sort of trying to correct for what seems to me to be a vast overemphasis on this Northern interpretation and Federalist ideology, because I do think that if you say there are these two understandings, and you could call them maybe the Massachusetts and the Virginia understanding, and you're trying to say, which of these was winning? Which of these was dominant in founding America? Which of these got more of what it wanted with the Constitution? Which of these was dominant, you know, even in the years running up to the Civil War? It looks to me like the Democratic-Republican version was winning. So this is why I say, look at the moments where the colonies speak with one voice. When people have to compromise and we have to come together and get unity, it's unity at what cost? And it's pretty consistently unity at the cost of equality. So you see that in the Declaration, I think, where Jefferson did have this passage that criticized the Atlantic slave trade. It gets taken out, right? And what stays in is the complaint that the British are emancipating slaves. Same thing happens in the drafting of the 1787 Constitution, in my view. The pro-slavery people get a lot more than they should have gotten. And if you look at the 1787 Constitution, I think that's a pro-slavery document. And it's sort of hard to figure out what the baseline is, but if you look at the Fifth Compromise, if you look at the Fugitive Slave Clause, it seems to me they're departing from the appropriate baseline in a pro-slavery direction. Now, there is, of course, anti-slavery constitutionalism. There are people who read the Constitution in a different way. And again, like my question is, well, how was anti-slavery constitutionalism doing in the years before the Civil War? Because Dred Scott is 7-2. So if we're trying to find what the mainstream understanding was, or sort of the median understanding was, I'm saying it's much farther in the direction of the Southern interpretation than we generally tell ourselves. Maybe one sort of numerical point of this is, I said there's maybe a Massachusetts version, there's maybe a Virginia version. Of our first four presidents, you get three from Virginia and one from Massachusetts. It tilts towards the South.
We're a little bit over time, but we're gonna have one last question before we wrap this up.
Thanks for coming back to your talk today. I thought it was very useful and very diplomatic in a lot of ways. I like your distinction there between true and useful. I think you both. I guess one thing I'd have to ask is your opinion on, you say, you know, you think that we can re-envision ourselves with air from reconstruction, not necessarily, you know, the original Constitution. And I like that you kind of reimagine it as a Civil War, sort of a revolutionary process. But do you think it's necessarily possible to kind of divorce our identity from that original, you know, founding document, as long as we're still using that document as our Constitution? Because, you know, comparisons say like Mexico, they had their war of independence and then they had their revolution some odd years later, so where they rewrote the Constitution. Do you think it's necessarily easy to divorce that from the document all our government works on?
Well, yeah, so I think that is one of the problems. I think that's one of the reasons that we have such a strong idea of continuity in ways that other countries don't. I think we underestimate the extent to which Reconstruction, particularly its process, was a revolution. And I think it's sort of a historical, it's an unfortunate turn of history that when the people were making the revolution, they didn't want to say it was a revolution because that was harder. So, you know, Lincoln doesn't want to say, I'm imposing new values. He wanted to say, these are the values that America has always been committed to. And the Reconstruction Congress didn't want to say, we're destroying the states and making new ones. Although Georgia, Alabama, and Florida filed suit and took it to the Supreme Court and said exactly that. And the Democratic Party in 1868, their platform says, these Reconstruction Acts are unconstitutional and revolutionary. But the people who were doing it didn't want to say that, because it's sort of more politically palatable to say, no, this isn't a revolution. And, you know, as far as the original Constitution goes, I think being left with equal state suffrage in the Senate, being left with the Electoral College, it's unfortunate. A lot of the bad provisions of our Constitution now are the structural ones, I think. So, like, the Fugitive Slave Clause was terrible, but that's gone. Equal state suffrage in the Senate is just getting worse and worse. You know, Senate malapportionment is, in my view, a very bad thing. It didn't used to be so bad because it didn't have a partisan dimension, but now that it does have a partisan dimension, I think empowering a minority to control the Senate is probably a bad thing. So I take your point. I don't know what we could do about it except have a new constitutional convention. I know that some people are interested in that. I think that would be possibly perilous, because who knows what will come out. But sometimes you need radical change.
That's a fantastic place to leave it. Can we have another round of applause?